Oh yeah.
Matrix sweat. Cha 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 cha.
Smells like kung fu.
I don't think you very often have the opportunity, frankly, to read something and go, you know something, this could really impact how we view a particular genre. Yeah, I think this has that opportunity, and I think people will mimic it.
Here they come, ladies and gentlemen, from Chicago, Illinois, the Wachowski Brothers!
I think the Matrix revolution has begun and continues to grow as time goes by.
We were really fortunate that Warner Brothers let us put the whole creative team of Matrix 2 and 3 under one roof.
Andy and Larry are in casting, and everybody else is running around like crazy trying to get it together. Still early on. We're actually testing some physical fights, and we'll be shooting some special effects for Matrix 2 and 3.
Well, we're preparing for the next two films, which means we are trying to flesh out what the film will look like.
We're trying to organize head castings for the actors so we can design glasses and helmets and head things for them.
We've got concept artists working on the movie. It's about five times as big and 10 times as difficult to put to paper.
Today we're training. It's the second week. Mr. Weaving, Agent Smith is over there learning how to fly punch.
There he goes.
We've got a long way to go. You know, with two films, there's twice as much as you would normally get on a film. And these two films are more complex than the first film.
When we made the first picture, nobody really knew we were doing. We were kind of under the radar. The only people that really had a sense of the movie were Larry and Andy Wachowski.
But I don't know how those guys stuck it out as long as they did, because it was gonna be made, it wasn't gonna be made.
The first Matrix, we were in Burbank in a kind of, I don't even know what it was, the empty warehouse.
And we didn't have anything there. We didn't have a coffee maker there. Or we certainly didn't have trailers or anywhere that we could actually sit and change. There was like one bathroom.
And there was a tiny little office with a couple of people running around, and it seemed very dinky compared to this.
Sort of like difference between working at NASA and working in like a cave.
Well, I remember, I mean, it was like a big accomplishment to get a drawing board, just to get them to write a check at that time early on for a drafting table was a commitment that they weren't willing to make. And now we have this, you know, really wonderful facility. It's really a dream come true.
This time around, we go in with, to some extent, a cult fan following, which is the greatest type of, you know, encouragement that you could have.
There's a lot less anxiety about whether or not we will be able to execute a lot of the choreography. We've been through it, so we're not, you know, sort of flying in the dark like we were the last time.
We know how hard it's gonna be, so it's, we know the challenges we have ahead of us.
Well, the thing about it, and it was true of the first one as well, is that, you know, I love the material. You know, I love the material, I love the character, and I love who I ended up working with. So that is something that, regardless of what has to happen, that's just, that's the thing that kind of gets me through it.
A friend of ours asked us to come up with a concept for a comic book. We didn't have any concepts, started thinking about something. Came up with the whole shebang. Every idea we've ever had in our entire lives is in this one film.
It's like a band's first album, the director's first film. They've thought about it for a long time. They really put their heart and soul in it.
When I first read The Matrix, there was a great deal about the Eastern influence, the comic book influence, that had been meshed into kind of Western philosophy.
There's a synthesis from the literature, from the exposure that they've had in cinema, from their lives, from what they're interested in, from what they find funny, from what they find cool.
We liked kung fu movies. We liked
Japanimation.
We like, you know, John Woo movies and books that are, you know, science fiction that is about the sort of nature of reality.
They really have a grasp of philosophy, of all types of philosophy, of Eastern philosophy, of you know, European philosophy.
Mayor and Andrew said, okay, we'd like you to play Thomas Anderson, Neo. I had to read Baudrillard. I had to read Out of Control, which was about systems, evolution, robots. And then there was another book, which was Evolutionary Psychology. Those were three books that they wanted me to read before I even opened up the script. Well, I mean, I guess for myself, to play Thomas Anderson, he was searching for the truth to his life. He felt that something was wrong. He felt like he was not having real contact. He was searching for something. He was searching. He felt that there was something behind the veil.
You ever have that feeling where you're not sure if you're awake or still dreaming?
All the time. And he was looking. So he was looking for Morpheus to try to break that veil. And I guess that is something that Baudrillard spoke about sometimes, but not in searching for something, but in what got in the way.
Baudrillard's ideas of simulacra, simulation, is an important point within the film, and that what we see in the film as a real object is in fact often a simulation.
He does one chapter, I believe, on like religious icons, where the icon starts to represent God and it loses its power of a true connection to God, because then you're the icon and then you have a simulation of an icon until it becomes on the dashboard of your car. You know, a decay of meaning.
You look at a place like Las Vegas where they're building
revels, the casino. The power of the simulacra. Like, you know, it's very relevant, very modern, important issue that youngsters like us are noodling about.
I read the Matrix script and really flipped out for it. Thought it was fantastic. Thought that as a script, the first 40 or 50 pages were the best 40 or 50 pages I'd ever read. And then I got very confused.
We went into the first Warner Brothers story meeting and they said, okay, now we know we've bought something cool. We don't know what it is.
Could you just take us through it once?
When I first read that script, I went, wow, am I in the Matrix or am I in the real world? Kind of, how do I get my head around all this?
I have to say I didn't understand the script. I mean, I understood the script well enough to say I liked it, but every time I reread it and every time we got closer, I understood more and more and more and more. I had questions forever and then would constantly try to change their plot, and they were, now, Bill, you just don't understand.
I have no idea why people who've read the script of the first Matrix found it confusing. I don't get that at all.
Upon reading the script and seeing the conceptuals, you know, at the same time,
You know, the immediate reaction is, there's no chance in hell this movie will be made. There's a whole slew of these scenes I see being chopped out or left on the floor that's just too unlike a large studio to take a chance on something that seems very alternative.
You know, I've said to people often that, you know, a movie this smart, it's almost a miracle that it got made because it is so smart.
It took me a lot of readings and a lot of conversations with everybody to fully understand the script. But I just remember thinking, I mean, they don't really think I'm gonna do this stuff like running, like jumping from one building to another. I was like, well, no, of course I'm not gonna do that. And like running sideways along a wall. It's like, because everything was really specifically put in the script.
They want you to understand what you're gonna see. And particularly in an action movie, it's very hard to do that because people aren't either used to reading it or they don't want to write it, you know? And, you know, the legendary story is that, you know, you'll see in a Western, you'll see, you know, 1/8 of a page and the Indians take the fort. That 1/8 of a page, the Indians take the fort, could take a month or two of shooting if you're going to. But, you know, that's the director and the stunt coordinator, everybody gets together and plans how the Indians take the fort. When these boys explain the helicopter sequence, or when they explain in the new movies the car chases, when they explain that stuff, they're very clear of what you're seeing, which A, makes it easier to budget than just the Indians take the fort, because you know where you're going. It makes it easier to see what's gonna happen, so it's easier to understand the picture. And it's also great because they know what they're doing.
Well, it's funny. I mean, one of the great things about them is how idealistic and ambitious they were when they sold us The Matrix. You know, they said, look, we have this trilogy. I said, well, let's just try to figure out one movie, guys. It'd be great to get the three, but let's try to one. They said, we want to direct it. And at the time, I said, look, you know, I don't know. I'm going to have a hard enough time explaining to people what it is we're going to try to make here. Now to try to sell you guys as first-time directors and this size scale with this kind of complexity, that you're asking too much of me, really. I don't know how to deliver that for you. So they wrote Bound.
I'm trying to seduce you. Why?
There was one scene in it, which was the sex scene, and they wrote in it, this is the sex scene, and we're not cutting it. And they wrote it in a script, and I like that. I like that it's funny, it's a little bit naive, and it's also tough.
It was fun because it was a low-budget movie, and we did the temp music ourselves. You know, we came up with stuff, and I cut it all in, and we really worked hands-on together very closely for a long time, and created this little, what to me is a little jewel of a movie. I love Bound.
I remember when I showed Terry Semel Bound, he was so impressed with it because they had just made a picture here called Diabolique that was not that effective. And I remember Terry said, God damn it. I said, this thing probably cost a fraction. He was talking about Bound, a fraction of our picture, and it's so much more interesting and exciting. And God, those guys are good. So that was the desired response.
At the end of Bound, when we were totally exhausted, and I think it was our last day, they said, hey, Pope, you want to do a $100 million movie next? I said, no, absolutely. I don't think you should do a $100 million movie. And even if you do, I don't want to do it. Because I know that the more money you have, the more heat rains down on you.
How are these guys going to make the jump from a $5 million movie to a $65 million movie? And I was afraid for them.
I kept trying to talk him into, let's do a $20 million movie, let's do a $10 million movie, let's work our way up. And they didn't listen to me, thank God.
I remember thinking, well, that's a lot of money. Well, they went from Bound to this big movie, and I know Bound was so great, but you know, a lot of times it doesn't happen. Studios aren't that trusting with people. And after spending an hour with them going through the storyboards, I totally understood why someone would trust them.
So few people understood the original script that they decided to storyboard the whole thing so they could explain it.
Nobody really understood, you know, the level of the action or the level of detail that we wanted in the action sequences and the conceptuals.
So what they really wanted to sort of jazz them about was, you know, the action sequences, which were
you know, like I said, very Hong Kong and comic book influenced.
You know, comics are graphic type storytelling when you can freeze a moment and make an image that sort of sustains and, you know, has a kind of power. You can't really do that in film either. We tried to do that.
They love comics, and they worked in the world of comics.
They wrote the first comic book that I ever got a chance to work on way back when. My big break in comics was called Ecto Kid.
And I remember going and watching them do storyboards early on, and they would act it out, and they and the storyboard artists would look, you know, this is the frame, and you could see they're drawing from life then. They're not drawing things that can't appear.
They're there for every shot. I don't ever just get a script, sit in a room, and come up with a bunch of stuff and say, hey, what do you think of this? They, you know, they go over every shot that they want.
What Larry and Andrew are doing sometimes is examining. They'll take an idea, and they'll see different sides, flip it around. Just look like, and that's even what their camera does. Here's an event. What does it look like over here? What does it look like from over here? Well, this is neat. This is interesting.
The immediate result of their comic background is that their storyboards were far more dramatic, and the moments that they select to actually draw, the snapshot in time, is often right on the head, the most maddening, the most, you know, emotionally evocative.
The whole notion of storyboards and what the Wachowskis do are just, there's no compatibility to that. These are paintings. They are, you know, they're master drawings. Jeff Darrow came aboard and did a lot of conceptual work.
I only knew two comics of Jeff's before. One of them, a legendary comic, Hard Boiled, of course, and then Big Boy, which was not so famous, but Hard Boiled among comics people is pretty well known.
I had Hard Boiled on my shelf like millions of other people, and all I could assume was that the man behind that was the most demented individual on the planet.
You know, I was expecting some guy, you know, with, you know, covered in tattoos and piercings.
I assumed he was, you know, a very skinny, scrawny methamphetamine abuser.
When Morpheus tells Neo he has to free his mind, you don't gotta say that to Jeff. Jeff's mind is free. I mean, he's out there.
I remember they tell me one guy wanted to know what kind of drugs I was taking. Sominex and Metamucil. They'd seen some drawings that I did that could have corresponded to images they had, especially with the sentinels and the robotic part of it. And I think they said that they liked the level of detail that I put in drawing.
You draw so many details that it becomes serene. At the same time, inside it, in every section of it, is madness.
In many ways, Jeff is wired to Larry and Andy's brain. I mean, they're all wired on the same circuit.
And during the entire period, you know, they were always, oh, I hope we can get this in there. I hope we have the budget for this, and I hope this looks the same. And at that point, I had no real experience in storyboards, and I had no idea how closely that they were going to get followed. I was amazed that they got everything as exact as they had wanted it. It's right out of their brains.
What we had to do really with the film was to establish, I think visually, the difference between the Matrix and the real world.
Our job was to differentiate the two worlds in as quiet a way and as pervasive a way so that it took you someplace, but not in an in-your-face manner. In the Matrix, everything was slightly decayed. Everything was slightly monolithic and grid-like, like a machine would make it.
And you're noticing things like the interrogation room or the government office. There are grids on the walls, there's grids on the floor, there's even grids in the ceiling. And so we're hoping that that will convey a feeling of artificial control, if you like.
Owen and I collaborated a lot on the strength of the tones of green in the Matrix. Also talked with Bill about you know, when the light hits a certain fabric or a certain leather, or how I could make it pick up green, or how I could make it pick up different colors.
In the Neb, we wanted it to be much more about the human beings, and so we used, you know, longer lenses and sort of let the backgrounds get all sort of soft and have the humans stand out more.
Their clothing is a little more humane and cloth-like, and their makeup is more natural, and their hair is more natural. They're less styled.
It was a very hand-hewn world as opposed to the Matrix. Also, they're a mercenary group of people, so they have more on their minds than fashion, you know?
The Matrix would always have like a green bias to it, whereas in the real world, we went for a blue bias, and we avoided green, except for Tank's console and the Nebuchadnezzar, which has got green code in it, which is, of course, the Matrix. So all of those things, which might not seem a great deal to anyone else, for anyone who's actually kind of work out the nuts and bolts of the film, it's, they're kind of like revelations, if you like. You know?
I guess my job is to try and create the environments for Larry and Andy and the actors to sort of work in.
What he did, what, you know, Australia, the whole art department pulled off, and it's most people won't believe it, I don't think. The largeness, the hugeness, the sort of complex set after complex set after complex set, and I built them all. They're all beautiful, they're all totally realistic.
I think his design was so spectacular that he even surprised Larry and Andy, and he kind of went further than they had imagined. That's a real credit for him.
We've sort of fallen back a great deal onto and utilised, as Larry and Andy wanted us to do, a lot of Jeff Darrow's drawings, which were the original conceptual thing. The case of turning a lot of Jeff's fantastic ideas into reality have meant some adaptions to, because we deal with gravity and not just a piece of paper, but essentially we're trying to sort of evoke that sort of world that he's developed, which is kind of cool.
Well, Owen Setz, you know, also being derivative of Jeff Darrow's demented imagination, were fascinating to look at. Most of them I wanted to turn into a nightclub after the film was done.
I think sometimes building sets is like the Matrix itself. On one side is plywood, and then you walk through a doorway, and there's another world.
Just being the Matrix, I mean, there's a kind of like simulation to every object.
That's kind of the illusion of the Matrix in itself, you know. Simulacra simulation was very much the case.
Basically, my job is to take the script and show people who the characters are by what they wear and why they would wear them in the environment in which they're placed.
Should we go to Lawrence next?
Yeah.
We've got two different kind of looks.
The directors come to the second fitting, and then we iron out things like, can you do kung fu? Can you hang from the ceiling upside down so we don't see up your dress? You know, we work out all the practical considerations, and I might use three different types of fabric for the same costume. So one might look the same but be stretchy because I have to put it over harnesses or body armor or, you know, bullet hits or whatever.
Visual effects, if you do it right, should be a part of the conceptual process, because if you are going after the unseen, then planning the unseen should involve the visual effects design. And Larry and Andy understood that right away, so they brought me in. It went during this time of development.
We were speaking before of the sort of impact that comic books can have in terms of their frozen graphic moments. What we really like about slow motion is that it sort of brings some of that quality to action scenes. But what we also like is we like to move the camera. So we started off and we had this concept of shooting something in slow motion and moving the camera at regular speed. And Bill Pope, the pussy, wouldn't strap a rocket to his back.
The discussion was, should we put a rocket on, you know, on a dolly so that it zooms real fast? Well, that wasn't really practical because, you know, you wouldn't really be able to focus and see the shot.
So it had to be some sort of effect. Somewhere along the line, they connected up with John Gade. I don't know how.
When we started preparing the first movie and started looking for a visual effects crew that would work with us, and we went to all the, you know, usual suspects. We went to ILM, we went to Digital Domain, we went to all these entities that are you know, well thought of in the world of visual effects. Gated was not part of that group. I mean, he was outside that world.
You know, they showed their boards a few places. Each time that they had done that, they tended to have a similar reaction. Faces turned white or some proposal for a physical camera invention that would effectively end up with the camera exploding because it would have to move too fast. It would be, you know, connected to a rocket sled or something like that in order to achieve their shots.
John's idea was to replace it with hundreds of still cameras so that that's really what a moving image is 100 still images. He can make it look like a motion picture image rather than a still image.
Bullet time is basically like mind over matrix moment, or a moment where we can see, you know, time in, you know, the speed of light or the speed of sound.
But I remember the first test I saw was an exploding trash can, and he froze the flames in the explosion in midair and moved the camera all the way around it.
Yeah, bullet time was really the technical hurdle, but the conceptual, you know, nut to crack was the portrayal of the real world, which was, oddly enough, the most bizarre part of the movie, which turned out to be the place where, you know, horrendous, hideous biomechanical beasties lived and ruled and enslaved mankind and all of those things.
I tried drawing the Sentinels and I didn't get what they wanted. And they called in a couple other guys and they had them do it and they couldn't get it. And I talked to them a little bit again. I said, let me have one more shot at it. And I drew it really, for me, razorly fast. I drew it one morning because they were going to Warner. And they said, I got it. And that was the basis for what the Sentinels turned out to be. So I was real happy because I think they're like the villains in the movie. And it's nice to have a piece of that.
It's just no good.
We're hoping to shoot the Kung Fu the way that Hong Kong guys do, which is have the real actors exchange 4, 5, 6 punches, to choreograph the fight like a dance, let it sort of happen in front of people instead of just creating it in the editing process. And that required all of the actors, all the 4 major actors anyway, to undergo some massively intense study with, we think, one of the best Hong Kong choreographers, Yuen Wu Ping.
With Hong Kong有啲唔同嘅，即係香港如果演員，或者即係平時拍一般動作片咧，即係演員打得梗係好啦。
Larry and Andy kept saying to me, we want the actors to actually be able to do the Kung Fu. We want them to do it. You know, I would say to them, you know, what's the big deal? Let's get the people who can do the Kung Fu. But the boys were convinced that they wanted to see these actors doing those things themselves.
Actors always bring more to believability of it than a stunt person is, no matter how good they are. If you can raise the actors up to the level of the stunt people and the action, then you've got the best of both worlds.
開始兩兄弟Andy 都已經識咗4個月嘅時間訓練㗎啦。即係我自己感覺上咧，就應該唔使係咪啊？應該即係2個月都已經好足㗎啦嘛，啊！ 後尾即係睇佢哋啲動作，打拳一腳都唔醒咧，我都頭暈啊！我都經4個月都唔得。
Sorry.
We were very upfront with how demanding we thought the film was going to be. And we were just hoping that, someone would
be crazy enough to do.
I had no idea what we were in for. You know, they said 4 months of training. I said, okay.
When I first talked to Larry and Andy, they said, you know, there'll be lots of training, kung fu training, and are you okay with that? And I said, yeah, sure, that's no problem, no problem at all. And I guess I didn't really think about it enough.
I totally knew, because I screen tested for 3 hours doing this stuff. This was part of my screen test, was 3 hours of what we do, straight, without, like, other actors to have time so that I can have a breather.
I'll tell you one thing, that those first 2 days kicked my ass.
After the first day, I was so shattered and so shocked, and I realized I was so unfit, and we had so much to do, and I was working with these incredibly skilled Hong Kong performers who were looking at me like, he'll never get there.
We started actually the last one on these bars. They had the bars and you just kind of put your leg up. As we would walk in and say, hey, Hugo, get your leg up. We'd all get our legs up. Get your leg up, Carrie Ann. Good morning, Keanu. Yes, get your leg up. And then you kick. Put some music on and you kick for about 45 minutes.
We're kicking and we're kicking and we're kicking and we're sweating and you're sweating and you're grunting and you're going, ow, you know, and the next day you come in limping.
So, you know, Keanu made this decision and, you know, went through what was arguably one of the toughest training periods for an actor in a modern film while he was recovering from surgery. It was neck.
Yeah, coming into the training for the first one, I'd had a two-level fusion in my cervical spine. I was getting paralyzed. So I had the surgery done, and then it was just a waiting game just to see if it would fuse. But it really hindered me a lot in training because I couldn't kick. I couldn't train kick for like two of the 4 months.
It was devastating to like watch. Because I was always
like, oh, like it hurt me to watch.
Wu Ping, the fight choreographer, was very nervous. And if you notice in the film, I don't kick that much. I do a couple of wire kicks, but I don't kick that much because I couldn't.
The Chinese have this saying, you know, you pick a job you love, you never work a day in your life. We're playing out there together, you know. There's a lot of playtime that goes into this sort of hard work of the training process and the choreography and the fighting and all that. We have fun with each other. And Hen Wu Ping is largely responsible for setting that kind of tone.
He's second generation. There's such a wealth of knowledge and experience. Him and the people that he works with are great teachers and, you know, instructors.
Yeah, well, we basically had the basic structure, the big broad structure of how we wanted the fights to work. And then he just would
rough in the fight.
He'd do some things, we'd see him, we'd decide what we liked, what we didn't like. Was just being able to see the guys jump and hit.
Jump and hit.
And one and the two shot.
Right.
How do they hit? I mean, is this just a takeoff?
This is a two shot.
Is this?
最后两个人在空中撞，也是这样，在空中一去，他我撑我，好像就空中杀。And when he fly, he actually fly out of the shot. Another one out of the shot, and then one shot they hit each other. That's what he's thinking.
That's what I thought he was thinking.
All right, okay. So you want to see them hitting, flying, hitting in one shot. Is that what you're thinking?
That's what we were thinking.
Too hard.
是不是太难受了？
不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，不，
He said he doesn't have enough people to draw.
Oh, guys.
Dude, we'll get on there.
Okay.
Go.
Both Wu Ping and the Wachowskis are working on the shots. It's all videotaped. It's all worked out where the camera goes.
And then basically they would start training the actors with the team to learn those exact moves, and they would just practice it over and over and over and over.
You sure we don't move on that? Just stand still, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. Coming at you.
Okay. I mean, the dojo fight with Keanu and I can't even tell you how many times we practiced that. Like, just the first part of it. You know, we spent, like, the first 2 months on just the first movements, you know.
He would look at us and develop with us, collaborate with whatever our body styles were, what our style was. He'd let that develop.
我企企緊嗰啲就個即係女人個身形美感嗰啲，我俾威壓架，教佢威壓跳啊彈啊，即係走路啊，即係個姿勢靚些少咁樣，即係佢呢啲係佢強項，佢動作即係有少美感咯。啊，羅仁兆咧，佢本身我覺得佢本身學得天啊，天生嗰種彈跳好啲嘅彈，Kenno咧，我覺得佢就好勤力，佢話即係次次覺得自己好似好唔夠咁樣，即係有時點解我哋禮拜日休息嘅嘛，有時禮拜日都要求我哋再練啦，即係練好啲，即係我覺得佢即係。
So maybe, come here.
Pam, pam.
Bang, bang. Maybe I can go, can I go like this?
Yeah, no problem.
And then step in?
Oh, yes, no problem.
And then, wah, wah, wah.
Yes.
Hugo呢，我覺得佢就比較硬正啊。 好，即係好似好啲人咁，砰砰喎！佢真係好似嗰啲人咁嘅啫，佢係好硬淨。
Not too much pressure, but enough, right?
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So. That's clean. The American training. Oh, good. It seems ready to go to Australia.
Well, yeah, I think we were ready. I mean, I know I was ready.
Let's go. Let's go.
What do you
Let's go.
Think?
Sydney's a beautiful town, I gotta tell you. I've never seen nothing quite like it.
The way it works, Chris.
Good.
Australia provided several things that were all related to economics that brought the cost of the film down quite dramatically.
It's odd that the studio was so hands-off with fairly new directors. I mean, they had done Bound, which was a great film previous, and I'm sure they had confidence, but obviously the budget had escalated quite a bit further than Bound's budget.
We didn't have as much immediate supervision. And I actually believe that ultimately allowed a lot more artistic integrity.
That's one of the reasons why we ended up going to Australia. I think the brothers knew instinctively that a long way away is better, especially for your first big movie.
No, we saw it as a way of
making a movie.
Making a movie. Could have gone anywhere, basically.
On the first day of the shoot, we had a kind of blessing, a Buddhist ceremony. We had a big pig, big feast.
Let's get some fruit, some candles, some incense. Auspicious day.
started filming, and we now look forward to like 5 months of filming, and we're just like at the beginning. It's almost hard to imagine the end part of it.
I felt like there was a really great excitement about it. I remember when we showed up, meeting the people who were building the sets. It was in a new studio. You know, costumes were being built. We were getting ready to go. And it seemed like everybody who was working on the picture had a genuine enthusiasm and excitement about what they were working on. I was feeling really good. And then I got the news that my neck didn't fuse. And so we had trained. What we try to do is train for the train and then fight. And then do the other, you know, and then train, have a chunk of time to train and fight. And so I was ready to go, and then they said, you can't fight. And I was like, yeah.
We knew that his neck was injured, and the schedule was backloaded action-wise so that in the beginning of the schedule, Keanu could do quieter scenes, and as he became more healthy, he could do the harder fighting scenes.
He needed to look ill at ease in his clothes, his suit at work, and kind of like someone who'd just woken up. So he was just a little bit disheveled and nothing quite fit him properly.
The brown coat, the brown jacket. Oh, it was fun. We went shopping for that. We went, I remember one of the first experiences I had with her was just going to a flea market, and to an antique kind of flea market, and just walking through and looking at, because we saw some shapes that were that worked on me and didn't work.
The most important part is the reveal.
Yeah.
And a bit of the
guy in a box.
Guy in a box. Guy in a box. Guy in a box.
What if they?
You guys met Robert?
Not yet.
This is
Larry.
Mr. Steadicam.
Hey, how are you, Robert?
Mr. Steadicam.
The bailout guy. The parachute.
The sweater.
Save us.
There's a good thing about two directors is they can act the movie out for you.
So show him that shot again, guys.
Go frame up this stuff.
This is a good thing about having two directors, I think. They can act out all the scenes and they can
action.
Oh, God.
Somebody's gonna be here.
We're gonna
have somebody doing photocopy.
Nice to meet you.
We'll see it and he'll say something.
Stand by.
Action.
We figured a lot out, working with each other, and how are we gonna make this picture?
Done it. Perfect.
Tap in.
Keanu's first trip back to the Matrix. This is Keanu. Once the veil has been lifted from his eyes, the first time back in the Matrix. That's his trip in that car through Chinatown.
Then I go for the jump and free my mind. I mean, I've tried to free my mind and I go for the jump. I learn I can die. And then I learn I can die in the neb. And then I find out that I'm not even the one.
The thing that used to convince him before he was told the truth, it now looks remarkably fake. So green screen is too sophisticated a technique. We can make it look real. So I wanted to use something as fake as Hitchcock's old rear screen projection, the same way, you know, Cary Grant looks fake driving down the street in North by Northwest.
They got a pretty cool quality out of it. I mean, it's an unusual thing to do these days, true, but the colors were nice and saturated, and the sort of defocused nature of it made it very dreamy.
Well, that was the first day I got to work with Mr. Fishburne, so that was cool.
Unbelievable.
But you know what I loved about that scene, it was great, was that even with the knowledge that what his life was, this kind of simulation, was that he's still fascinated by the technology of what the Matrix is.
Thank you.
Well, Lawrence is perfect for his part because he has like a regal kind of bearing. We dressed him very formally because he is a formal character. He's like the guide through the world.
Mmm, oh, nice. G'day. Here we are in Oz. And I've one question. Where's Skippy?
So we decided to include that in the scene near the fountain to continue that idea of the Matrix was glitching. So we cast a lot of twins and triplets as where we could and then costumed them identically. And I don't know if many people would notice it, but we thought it was a good idea.
Okay. You want to put some twins in this? I've got twins over there. I mean, how many twins do you want in here?
Could you pull a few, couple nuns, like right to the second row?
The Matrix is a system, Neo.
Monday. Hey! Monday, I will no longer just be a computer nerd. I will be a superhero. I can fly. Stop it. Stop. Go.
They agree on everything. How does that tell you what I think of your idea?
Are you listening to me, Neo? Were you watching The Woman in Red?
Look again.
It's hard to hold this damn gun. It's like holding a brick.
So you liked this better than anything? Or just or nothing? Freeze it. Just freeze it.
We'll try it clean and naked.
Clean and naked.
Freeze it.
We're establishing everybody in these shots?
Yeah, the order of events is we're going to shoot the background with nobody in it whatsoever. Then we're going to shoot the fountain with a really closed down shutter, which means right. Like when you shoot those water commercials, you want them like super crisp. Then we bring in the crowd. We shoot those guys for all the three angles. And while the people are walking through the frame, we're going to ramp the camera from 24 to 96, right? And in that moment, we're going to stop. We're going to pick a frame that looks crisp and digitally hold that frame for the rest of the scene. So everyone's like stuck.
This isn't the Matrix.
No. It's another training program designed to teach you one thing. You are not one of us, you are one of them.
I like playing villains if they have a sense of humor. And I think that was the key thing with Smith, was that I always thought he was funny. He amused me, and so it was much easier for me to enjoy playing him.
We wanted to subconsciously convey like the idea of a secret agent look and that kind of 60s silhouette seemed to fit really well. You know, JFK undercover look seemed to be the right one.
I was actually very excited when we got to do that scene because I felt for the first time I was actually acting. I was actually involved in something that was gonna extend me, I suppose.
Door. Cut.
Suddenly, after all these months and months of kind of preparing for something, I felt like I was actually involved in it.
To work with Hugo Weaving like that was just, and to see what he was doing as Smith was so fantastic.
As you can see, we've had our eye on you for some time now, Mr. Anderson. It seems that you've been living two lives.
We tried to just go for a very neutral accent, but a more specific character. And the character kind of evolved that I wanted him to be not robotic, but not really human, and more like, I kept thinking about a 50s newsreader or someone like that.
It's Walter Cronkite.
It sounds like, you know, that's the way it is, you know? So great.
One life, you're Thomas A. Anderson, program writer for a respectable software company.
And also, the more I hung out with Larry and Andy, the more I think I picked up on their rhythms. Larry and Andy both have an incredibly deep voice, and I think that kind of Agent Smith started to kind of talk a little bit like that as well.
One of these lives has a future. One of them does not.
Somebody said he was imitating us at one point. We fired them.
How about I give you the finger and you give me my phone call?
To play what was going on, I got scared, but also kind of the you know, the kind of the some of the chutzpah that Thomas Anderson has, you know, fuck you, man, fuck you.
Yeah, I keep getting into this attitude when I do it, like the guy just turns into this guy. Like, man, I feel like I'm like some 70s hippie guy. You know what I mean? I really feel like, dude, I turned into that.
And then, of course, then to do the special effect and to have the mouth covered for 5 hours. Because I hadn't thought of how I would communicate that day, and all of a sudden I found myself. Kind of trying to find a pen.
What?
Some papers?
Write faster, we're on the clock here.
He's writing on
hit, resist. Swing at agents. They're pretty mighty.
Action!
You're going to help us, Mr. Anderson, whether you want to.
That was a good day. That was a fun day. Physically debilitating to go up on top of all those rooftops. You had to get the gear up there. You had to bring the gear down. I was excited. It was, okay, here we are. How's this gonna happen? What are we gonna do? Can we do it? What's it gonna be like?
I feel that it's gonna be good. Sometimes you gotta go with the flow. You know what flow is, backwards.
Ken 同埋 Kendall 都每一兩個鏡頭都差唔多打，就講。 我感覺出嚟就好似開始嚟講，我感覺 Ken 啲動作嘅仲係好生硬。
RP, we are under attack.
I remember the first thing I had to do in the Matrix was a forekick. I was like, kick him in the head. I kick him in the head? I've been training for 4 months not to kick anyone in the head. Kick him in the head. Okay.
Kendall 有一個鏡頭，即係捉住人，啪啪啪啪踢幾腳，踢幾多個，跟住曬個前邊有幾個已經 OK 啦，佢仲想要好啲，即係我力就要 cut。Kendall 好似有啲唔高興，我點解唔俾我跑啫？即係我同佢解釋話，我哋係專業人士嚟嘅，我哋話 OK 就一定 OK 嘅，你放心啦咁樣。
Oh my gosh, and that first day we did it on the rooftop, I woke up with it, like my neck went out and I couldn't move and I was crying, you know, thinking, oh no, and they brought a masseuse over to get it out and we did it. Thank God for Advil.
It's gonna be good.
As this guy's pitching back, right?
He's gotta reveal Trinity in the distance and Keanu close.
Is it a solid or is it?
It's a good test for anybody.
Those things are sort of slow.
Maybe we shoot it.
He should like go
and then fall out of it.
Excuse me, mate, could you pull that out of my head, thanks.
Trinity! Help!
You guys suck!
So you go from the 150 to Trinity, help.
Oh, you want to be in on that?
Yeah.
Go down here.
No.
Just let him down.
Cut. Cut.
Was the second
attempt? The second one was good.
Yeah, it was okay.
That's
what the book. Okay, so you've got that one. Okay.
Well, this isn't bullet time. This is bullet time action. That was the backup plan. We had not completed making the special rig that we knew we needed to do the real shot yet. We wanted to make sure that we could do that scene if the bullet time process didn't work. And we had all these rehearsals with stunt folks. You know, there was some rigidity about it, or there was like something, there was something about it that just felt clunky, and we were really worried that Keanu would not be able to even go that far.
Can we do one where he goes to try to start back the other way?
And all of his performances were much more fluid, that there was this extra like inertia, you know, emotional inertia that allowed him to stretch his body into that ultra limbo like position.
I mean, the hit.
Yes.
Okay. 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 And you want this knee to come up?
Yeah.
Dodge this.
Get us complete checks, please. Anybody shoot?
The most bare skin of everybody, so that you had that distinct difference between something black and shiny and kind of metallic looking and then somebody's flesh. We spent a lot of time experimenting with, you know, what different fabrics did in different types of light so that we could get Trinity really like a mercury oil slick.
I spent a lot of time last time on the wires because I did wire work. It's challenging, and then all of a sudden you kind of like find your way with the wire, and you feel like it's also very sore, like it hurts to do the wire. But then you kind of find your way on it. Suddenly you're able to do things that you didn't really think you could do. It's sort of more of your mind getting around it than anything. No one on the crew knew what we were doing. And when I'm running alongside a wall, and I really am running alongside a wall, you know, I remember the nurse being like, do you need Gatorade? I think she's done too much. I'm like, no, I want to do it again. I want to do it again. It's just so exciting. Don't like work on wires all the time. You know, it's sort of a specialized thing. And so my stunt double, it just didn't feel right watching it. And so Larry and Andy were like, they turned around, looked at me, and I said, okay.
Try it.
Try a bit change.
Yep.
And I got up and did it.
To move inside and make the government lobby, seeing the world change.
I give you a finger, and you give me that finger.
Once we shot and cut the government lobby, the cloud lifted, and the Matrix had a voice, and it became obvious that this was a movie unlike anything you'd ever seen before.
There's this one sequence where they're panning with me as I'm running down with the guns. You know, they're literally setting off 1,000 bullet hits and moving it, 5 cameras. And I love that kind of, that moment where it's sirens go off and, you know, it's like, here we go, you know, and we got to shoot now and you got to hit it.
They said, we need a foyer for an office building. And it's kind of like a mausoleum, you know. They wanted to be able to run along the walls. They wanted to be able to do cartwheels. So you obviously had a lot of wire work, so you needed to build a set that you could either access from the middle with wires or lower parts.
Would you please remove any metallic items you're carrying? Keys, loose change.
Holy shit! He needed clothes that would be practical within those actions. And he had a lot of guns to carry, and he had to conceal them. I wanted him to have a bit of a gun-slinging attitude.
And then you just keep rolling. Ready,
I wanted a very specific, very stylized approach to the destruction. Basically, we wanted to be able to have these concrete pillars be reduced to apple cores.
Okay, Trinity time.
I understood something very important that day during the government lobby. And that was the pressure that I had on my shoulders and that Keanu had on his shoulders. And I had never felt that before.
One, two, three, lead!
Because I'd learned, like, running along the wall, but the cartwheel part is really hard. And so I had never gotten it right. I just started to get it kind of right. And so I started rehearsing that morning, and I started to get it right, you know? The stakes are higher, I guess. And then I hurt myself. I hurt my ankle.
Ah! Oh, no. Oh, no.
I remember thinking in the moment that I hurt my ankle that, oh, my God, I'm down. But I can't be down. And then when I was told that it was just, like, one take and I just was like, okay, no matter what, I'm gonna be able to do this. No matter what, I'm gonna do this. No matter what, I'm gonna do this. It was very heavy.
Beautiful.
Yeah. So I'm leaning forward, right?
Yeah.
Sideways. Okay, straight.
Go. Yeah, right.
Great.
That's good.
Okay. 客人緊張, 練嗰時候都做到, 都好。
到現場拍到不知道緊張，成日都那個力有點錯了，那個就分了，一走一翻再接著，即是變了兩個鏡頭。
To see Keanu do that quadruple kick and that they've been practicing for 4 months and suddenly see it work, and we were... It was great. Great moment.
Yeah! Forget the handstand. Ancient history.
Be here now.
You gonna rehearse?
You want to?
Yeah. Well, I haven't kicked with the guns and I haven't needed the coat.
Good idea.
Let's check your frames. Let Reeves warm up.
We would do it. It wouldn't be good enough. They would talk. And they come over and say, well, it would be, could you get it like this? And then we try again. That's the way it should be. You try it, you look at it, you do it, you talk. You know when to leave it alone, know when to keep going. I tended to not know when to leave it alone and to keep going.
Hands. But it's okay, oh, right? Okay. American style.
It's okay. No, Kung Fu style is good.
Well, I don't know, because I want super take. You know, what I called super perfect.
He was the last to give in. He was the last to say, this is the best we're going to do, and let's move on.
You're going to do better than that? Well, you have a good end. Actually, you have a good end. You have a good quality.
Hold on. Good.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
You want
to try one more?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll try one more.
Okay.
He wants to try
one more. If you do one, you do two.
Two more.
He's a perfectionist, and he felt that there was something special about the whole experience, the whole picture, the whole everything, and he wanted to get it as right as possible.
Keanu, of course, wasn't satisfied. It had to be super perfect.
Cut.
8 days till dojo.
8 days, that's an eternity. That's an eternity.
The idea was a traditional Japanese style building, or at least that influence, set up for fighting. The dojo, in fact, had been built well before we actually were going to shoot. And because of the injury to Keanu Reeves' neck, we couldn't actually film that set. So the actors had rehearsed in it for about a month beforehand.
This is the moment you've been waiting for! Oh, good morning. Here we are.
We should get into this.
Day one of shooting, technically. This day one. This will start.
That's where that's.
Poses that you do in Kung Fu have meaning, and they are very specific. It is a dance, and Wu Ping is very exacting.
And I think a lot of times that the brothers were looking to Wu Ping for his, you know, seal of approval on whether or not we'd executed it the right way.
Keanu and I were very much in sync with each other by that time. You know, we had been practicing these movements for like 8 months, but we hadn't really gone full out until I think we got there.
We were always concerned about the dojo scene. I was sure they were going to get hurt. They thought they were going to do full contact. They'd kill each other.
You could tell the actors were totally, totally into it. And Keanu's little ad lib of that thing, which is another one of those things that we didn't make up till the moment, the zoom on, the kung fu zoom on Keanu. Sort of the little magic things that happen.
We did 21 takes of the three kicks. Keanu goes up, kicks me three times. And that was partly because he hadn't been up in a wire in a long time. There was no rehearsal time for him to go up.
Should I try and jump up or just go straight?
You go straight.
You know, he wasn't prepared for that day.
It's hard to see your friend be so hard on themselves, but that's just his, you know, you kind of have to leave room for people to do what they do, you know? And he's not always like that, but, you know, there's times you just, you know, your heart breaks because you just wish he wouldn't be so hard on himself.
Yeah,
you're
right.
Don't have to speed up.
That was better kicking.
I couldn't get the triple kick, I couldn't do it. I was in this harness and I was like mad and I'm screaming. I just can't fucking do this fucking kick now. Just let me fucking, we'll just shoot on fucking Monday, okay, man?
Cut. Good
kick, right? Bad hands.
Yeah.
I don't know what to tell you.
Got there on Monday. I think it was three takes. Triple kick.
Morpheus to be able to do this extraordinary kind of eagle flying kind of kick. And they used a heck of a lot of light in it.
Incredible amount of light, high speed cameras. There's this great moment Lawrence had in the dojo scene where he comes over to Keanu after he's sort of knocked him back.
Fuck!
And we could tell that Lawrence was, by God, he's into this thing. He's, and he starts coming at him.
Cut.
The most surprising thing was that we hurt each other a little bit. You know, we bruised each other up pretty badly.
When we were training, you had no contact, or you'd have light contact. And then there were certain moments where you had to have more power.
You know, we weren't pulling. You know, we had been practicing these movements for like 8 months, but we hadn't really gone full out until I think we got there. I was surprised by what happens when you smash forearms with somebody that hard, that often.
There's a sequence where I fly over him, do a backflip, and land in front of him, and he turns and hits me. And I got a pretty good sternum shot there.
After the kung fu, the dojo scene, Lawrence and Keanu are both just covered in bruises and scrapes and burns from the Tommy mats and, you know, harness burns from the rope, from the wire work.
Ready? I just want to flip over, and I want to keep my hands in, and I want to kick back, and I want to tuck.
Okay.
Yeah, his body is, he's leaving from the spot that I'm stepping to make this week.
Exactly. And action!
Cut.
點功即係教功夫打到好傷嘅，我講咗啲少少，到滅口停，即係唔會打落去㗎啦。
Know what you're trying to do.
I'm trying to free your mind, Neo.
During the subway sequence, Leonid got sick. We were in down coats in the summertime. It was a cold set, it was a damp set. What looks like a really simple scene just took forever and ever.
The initial plan was, well, we'll go to a real subway station and we'll film. And then when you looked at what had to happen in this environment, it became kind of obvious that we couldn't shoot in a real subway.
The set was fantastic. I think it was actually part of an old wheat storage facility. There was a real train track, which they kind of built a subway station around. Was fun, except once you're in a wire and you're stuck in the wire and in harness for a long time, the harness starts riding up. And it's got to be pretty tight. And I remember it squeezing my kidneys.
If you do it right, they're fun. If you do them wrong, they hurt.
You're empty. So are you.
Hugo Weaving, relaxing at home. Now the gun's supposed to be at each other's. What are we doing?
Directors!
Yes!
Okay. He's right in here. Where do you want these things?
Just go up to like an inch away.
Oh. So don't put it to his tip.
Right.
Like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that area. Yeah, that's good. That's
what does good. It look like right against his head? Just do that.
Okay, that's pretty good.
Action.
You're empty. So are you.
Good one. Cut.
Cut.
When we were shooting the subway scene, we had to really contact each other, really kick each other, really punch each other. There was major contact happening.
Okay, Hugo. Yeah.
All right. And after the dojo, I realized that how we train and how we film are two different things, because you have to have contact. And we had to start hitting each other. You couldn't just fake it, because with the way they were shooting, you had to hit.
Yeah, I just want to drop it. I almost dropped this question.
Oh, no. I find particularly taking the hits more difficult than delivering them. When you're taking hits, you feel like, well, between that hit, I want to actually get in another one. So I found that more difficult.
If you have your feet higher than your head, it'll
jack
it. So have your feet lower than your head.
I got to work with an exceptional stuntman and Chad Stahelski. When I speak about the fights and what, you know, the action, I think of it as the two of us.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, get it, stop!
I think that Chad comes in for when there's situations where you don't put an actor slamming into a wall, you know, upside down and drop 10 feet. Chad did the upside down hit, and then after that, he had to do the
ceiling hit where the subway's coming, and Smith is on top of him. What happens when they came down, the other stunt man, I guess Chad was on the bottom. And Len on the one knee, and I think his knee broke, and his shoulder, tore ligaments in his knees, dislocated his shoulders, broke some ribs. They had this contraption, the monster, which was a hydraulic air pressure. It kept driving people into the ground. So Darko went from the, he had to crash with his newsstand.
That was very scary for everybody because we thought he maybe might have, you know, been very badly injured or perhaps even killed. And we were really worried about that. And that was a horrible evening for everyone.
Fortunately, right toward the end, it was Larry's birthday, and his parents came, and sort of the fog lifted for a couple of days, and we managed to get out of there.
So I can get up, his wife coming up, and look, I can get up, look at him.
Yeah, get up, look, wife. Almost like the wife takes you straight in.
Okay.
Not in the fucking standing in the aisles at that point.
I remember sitting in there thinking I was in an office block looking overlooking Sydney, and there was this fantastic cyclorama of the Sydney skyscape. It was completely real, except it wasn't, like the movie.
It was really cool to be able to stand up on that floor and walk from one office to another office and another office and never once lose sight of the translate.
Biggest translate in the world, like that? Are you interested in a stat like that, a little stat like
is
that?
Is it the biggest translate?
The biggest one-piece translate in the world. Yes, it is, Josh.
We did computer generate the translate so that Sydney was not identifiable.
There's a few buildings in this background that are not where they really are, because we're covering the Opera House and we're covering Sydney Harbour Bridge. And I mean, even though the movie takes place, we're not saying it's not Sydney, it's just an unnamed city.
I'd like to share a revelation that I've had during my time here.
Smith, prior to that scene's totally in control, cold, doesn't show much emotion, if any. And during that scene, he starts to feel angry and feel frustrated because he can't get the information out of Morpheus.
I hate this place, this zoo, this prison.
He's starting to smell things, and he's starting to be like a real person, and he doesn't like it. He doesn't like feeling emotions, and he doesn't like being weak.
I can taste your stink. And every time I do, I fear that I've somehow been infected by it.
By all intents and purposes, he would be partly human, I suppose. Partly real.
I like to think that Morpheus is aware of everything that's going on in that scene, or at least he's struggling to maintain his awareness.
Oh, it's actually about trying it's to about hold your mind.
Hold my mind in a place
closed.
Where they can. Yes. So I basically shut my mind off.
Yeah.
Or I've drawn a curtain in front of the information that they want.
There's another part of me that was really sort of sad that I didn't have any dialogue so that I could have a conversation with Agent Smith so I could say that, you know, oh man, I played this scene with Hugo Weaving, it was great. But, you know, I did play this scene with Hugo Weaving, and it was great.
Find them and destroy them.
And don't forget your line.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Find them and destroy them.
When the sprinklers went off and it
poured into the room and we were all drenched and soaked and things were floating around and it was a kind of dangerous live wet set. And it was fantastic fun. I enjoyed that week a lot.
We had very difficult issues with the water. That was an early situation that the studio also was concerned. We need the water, we need the water. And the boys felt that the water was crucial.
When the sprinklers came on and that set, the water that came out of the sprinklers all had to be hygienic, you know, because there were upwards of 100 people up on that roof at various times, breathing in the water that was coming through the system and breathing out it, obviously. It all had to become sterilized before it was kind of pumped back in. It all had to be heated. There were many little elements that kind of went into it.
And you forget about the helicopter coming down and shooting
the office. Oh, yeah.
That entire helicopter rig, which was a full-scale helicopter, not a real one, but made lightweight by Owen, and it had to operate on all axes and lift off and take off. The blades were all put in later by the visual effects people.
Come on, honey, take us off.
Hey, baby, you in there tight?
I'm in there tight. Snuggest bug in the road. Let's fly.
Or do you want me up like this?
That's the one. That's the look.
No.
It was very weird when I realized that it was all sort of rigged with explosives. You know, I had a moment's pause there. I kind of went, hey, who's responsible for this?
You know?
Steve Courtley and his crew built into the floor 350 air-controlled nozzles, which would, when the set was filled with water, simulate the machine gun fire from Neo, who was hanging in a helicopter just outside the window.
And then you had that shootout of the glass in a particular pattern.
And as you arc around that, that's when you're arcing around the other wall to get Jones.
There's a moment where you shoot everything and then they cue the window. It was mind-blowing. The glass had to be blown out. And the only way to make it safe for the actors, the glass had to be blown out with pea shooters blowing sand. Hundreds of them lined up out of frame.
He's not gonna make it.
It's kind of ironic in that to achieve what seems like a fairly simple thing to do, to fly a helicopter down the front of a building, shoot a window out, and rescue someone by jumping out the window. It's been over 6 months to actually achieve that whole element, because at the beginning of the film, we were shooting on a government roof. At this point, we're nearly end of the film, and we're still shooting that same sequence. We're trying to get the Nebuchadnezzar finished for filming next week. There's always those final last-minute adjustments we're going to do.
I remember everyone was excited to walk on the Nebuchadnezzar. That was really a cool day.
It was exciting. It was like a new world going into a new thing. And it was sad, too, because we had to say goodbye to the wire team. It's heavy.
In the Neb, it's crawling with sort of Jeff Darrow sort of technology, which almost has this organic quality. It's this sort of industrially
jungle,
gadgety jungle, cables and everything.
You know, it's built long before the movie takes place, so it's an old ship. It's been around forever. It's just kind of been held together by the loving care of the crew.
I just wanted to look old and put together and not, you know, not Star Trek-y where they're all components. It had to look like it was, they're constantly putting it back together and using pieces from this and that. And
they really tried to bring the guts of the spaceship, if you like, out into the spaceship as opposed to burying it behind the sort of normal vac form sort of style thing that you might see in a lot of spaceships.
Everything is considered, even the wires in the Neb. There was, you know, the blue and red wires, arteries, veins, you know, representative of this kind of
you know, living tissue in this steel ectoskeleton. You know? That marriage and of machine and man everywhere in the picture, everywhere.
It's almost Chinese, Sanskrit. It's not even numbers, it's weird.
We've almost become other characters.
That's the story.
Raindrop kind of screen effect.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of work been gone into buying various old dentist chairs from the 1920s, which we have taken ideas from making the ecto chairs.
And take it right down to the ground, please.
And I loved the chairs, and I loved, you know, the whole, the brutalness of that, needle that goes in your head, you know, the crudeness of it.
You wanted to know what the Matrix is, Neo.
The masculine side of Morpheus is really evident in The Matrix, and his feminine side is evident in The Neb.
Try to relax.
I wanted him to feel like a den mother, almost.
I love you.
Cut, there's a
fighter. And
fight.
I just think if she's just more, maybe feminine even, because she's really kind of, you know, warrior-like in The Matrix, and then in The Neb, she's more of a woman, I think. No!
Sentinel,
this is what we're looking at.
Pow!
Now.
As soon as you see that thing go,
yeah.
You would say now.
And my hand is on here, and I pull this out at the same time. I say now, and then push.
Oh.
Thanks, guys.
I know.
Bye.
Is it before the now or after?
After.
After the now? How does she know I'm back?
She's connected to you.
So it's not because I open my eyes?
No. Nope.
Why not?
I just want to see your eyes open. Dark.
If she pulls the plug, how does she know I'm back?
She knows.
Is there any cue from her phone? Is there? How does she know?
She knows. Sure, if you want. You want to grab it?
Sure.
I want it to break.
No. Stop it going on the line.
Is he back?
Yeah.
Rehearsal
and action.
Bang, bang,
bang, bang, bang.
No.
Action!
Sentinel!
No!
Pete! No!
Kale.
Where's the mango? Right now, it's hard onto this. It's completely sealed. I'm only coming through here and now it's into
it. I just want to go on record saying this is disgusting.
Oh, Lillian.
We're proving our love for our babies right here.
Baby's not acting enough.
Bring your baby up.
Originally, when they were talking about the power plant, and Jeff was in France drawing it, and Larry gets the first fax, it was a lot more scary than he'd imagined.
They wanted it to look like it was something that get away from that stainless steel, very clean, science fiction-y look, and to make it look, you know, kind of dirty and used and ugly.
Before we actually shot the pod, we had shot it about 7 times, mainly on video, but the stunt guys have had to get inside it to see how the breathing mechanism would work. The special effects guys had to test how their skins broke. The prosthetics man had to deal with all of these little pieces the prop guys had made.
I feel bad for Darko, who was doing some of the testing. He had, originally when they put the goo in there, he didn't. He had hypothermia in like 8 minutes.
Okay, let's get him out of there now. Thank you very much, Darko.
By the time the actor got in there, they figured out they should heat it up.
Give him another one and let him get on his arms.
This part.
You want my hands?
that pod and that pod?
All three.
All three?
I can't do all three.
Not that much, but out is
I'm
good.
I have the chaos to do all three. Have I?
That's good.
That's good.
And action.
Light.
You know, we were shooting the end of the movie, and he, you know, he had lost a lot of weight, and he shed another 15 pounds for the end of the pod sequence there.
I mean, I wanted to look very, you know, emaciated when I came out of the pod and when I'm on the table to recovery, and I think got the effect there pretty good.
He shaved everything, you know, his head, his eyebrows.
The thing about that is just people I found when I would have conversations with people, they would be kind of like, and I'd be talking to them and they wouldn't look at me. It's weird.
Now!
Go!
It kind of felt like we just sort of crashed to the end, you know? It wasn't a graceful end. We just were trying really hard to get everything done.
Hey. Thanks, folks. That completes principal photography on The Matrix.
I remember distinctly feeling very tired and very relieved at 1:01 in the morning when we ramped, which was Neo's number, by the way.
I remember like walking from work, and you know, they do the whole thing, and they say it's a picture wrap, you know, and it's so intense. I mean, it was just crazy. And I was walking back to my trailer, and I remember saying to myself, I will never care this much again, because it's too painful. It took me months to get over it. People were like, let it go. Let go of The Matrix. I was like, I can't. Such an amazing experience.
Well, we've been shooting for 25 weeks, 118 days.
It's like, okay, when are we starting? Okay, and when are we supposed to finish? Okay, and I'm just committed for all of that, you know? I've never really been able to break it down. I think that has to do with my experience on Apocalypse Now, which was the other never-ending film.
You know, you don't expect any film to be as successful as The Matrix was, so I guess we hope everyone that you work on will be, because, you know, you kind of die a little bit every time you finish a film. You know, you leave a lot behind.
Editing is all about, it's a cumulative process, and it's all about trying different things, taking things out, putting things in, you know, taking two steps forward and one step back, being not glued into your ideas, being open to what the film wants to be. There's always a core that they're working around. There's a moment in each scene where there's a shot that's so clearly designed as a key spot, and the scene leads up to that point, or it comes down from that point, but it really gives you something to work around. It gives me something to work around as the editor.
The way a shot's typically set up, you show up and there's only one shot. That's the only shot they're interested in getting. And you look for it. You take the finder and they look for it, and you can spend a long time, a lot longer than most crews are used to, looking for that shot, working it out, getting it right. But it's so time efficient because that is the shot. You don't have to come up with other coverage. This shot leads to the next shot. And you only have to shoot exactly what's being used.
They just shoot what they need, which is very economical. And also, you know, it's fun to watch it, because when they shoot it, you see what it seems gonna look like, and you see what you're gonna get.
We had visual effects companies in Sydney and in the US. Mannix is the main company out of San Francisco, but we had two companies, Animal Logic and D-Film, in Sydney that did a significant amount of visual effects. Mannix, I gave almost all the creature work, went there, and the bullet time type stuff. Animal Logic, I gave them a big climactic code hallway and like the exploding agent. D-Film tended to do difficult compositing, things like when Neo jumps off the skyscraper, and they did the helicopter crash and things of that nature.
Early on, the studio tried to get us to take out the helicopter scene. They thought we didn't need to add that as well. And of course, we were passionate about the whole sequence. They eventually agreed.
Well, the helicopter crash is, I guess, one of the big money shots for the film, because it's just so outrageously complex and so just visually intense that it's really trying to be the definitive action sequence, or at least that's our interpretation of it.
So the combination of miniatures with live action, with stunts, with CGI, it's just, it's a very big, big sequence.
We were very specific and we wanted the glass to explode in sort of an ever-expanding circle. And to actually figure out how to make the glass do that and to figure out basically what glass to use and what explosives to use probably took 3 months of heavy-duty research.
This was basically concentric rings put behind the glass with pyro charges that were all triggered to a certain timing. One. We built a 25-foot square glass wall to scale of these windows. We built a quarter-scale helicopter with its blades and was mounted to a large crane arm. That was the very first thing that we started doing in 1996, and that was one of the last four shots that we finished in the movie. And you're working the entire time towards making it perfect, and all the little pieces, there are a million little pieces that were invented to make that make sense. We had virtual backgrounds, which were ways of literally photographing the real world with still cameras and extracting from the stills both shape and texture and then making a CG construction out of that.
Once we've reconstructed it, now we can move your virtual CG camera around anywhere in that set. It's used to basically put together backgrounds for shots where we could never have conceivably shot it with a camera. You know, if you'd have done this with a camera, you'd have seen camera track, rails, rig, crew, people. This allows us to go in there, like take the stills when the set's empty, and then build the whole set artificially, in fact. And you get a photorealistic set.
Everything begins with the simulation, and all the math for how to shoot it works backwards from there. In this particular rig, there are 120 cameras and two motion picture cameras set up. We analyze what real frames we have, and we can create new frames of moments in between the captured frames to make moves longer or stretch them out or do time compression effects. Tests trying to find the texture of the pod. The whole sort of like look of a lot of the computer graphic creatures and environments is based on undersea life. They're much more light absorbing and scattery light and wild colors and things like that, which no other creatures to date really have this kind of quality. Everything else is out in the sun or in like, you know, whatever, normal lighting, traditional lighting. How about, you got like, let's see some pods. This is all computer graphics. It's like the, we're just talking the babies.
Yeah.
Grow inside there. And it's sort of like Big Daddy Roth meets Jacques Cousteau. Just bring the animation until like there, yeah, then cut it off.
Okay.
So you see, it's all fake. It's no real babies. Totally harmless.
I believe in film as a visual medium, first and foremost. I think sound, meaning sound effects and music, are incredible, powerful tools.
Easy, Neo. Easy.
Get this thing out of me. Get this thing out of me. Don't touch me. Get away from me. Stay away from me.
But I think ideally the film should stand up on its own. So I'm a big fan of, at least through the very first cut, keeping the film pretty raw and pretty naked. So you can watch it and get some rhythm from it without the help of music and effects.
Easy, Neo. Easy.
Get this thing out of me. Get this thing out of me. Don't touch me. Get away from me. Stay away from me.
Because music and effects are always going to make the film stronger. But you don't want them to become a crutch, at least without knowing they are going to become one. Sometimes you say, I need that crutch.
I am a sound designer, supervising sound editor. It basically means I'm responsible for coming up with all the noises in the movie.
This will feel a little weird.
You know, obviously there were a lot of definitions in that movie about the nature of reality, and so I had to make a lot of definitions about the nature of the sound that defined reality or non-reality.
No one's familiar with the sound of a squiddy. No one's familiar with the sound that the Neb makes.
We're watching dailies, and there was the incredible shot where the camera is pulling over the fetus, or not the fetus, the baby that was in the pod, and it's filling up with water, and the camera is pulling over it, and then the valve closes up. As the first take of that came up, they made this, like, shunk sound effect with their mouths. You know, it's to them like they had the sync track in their head running. It's usually a pretty good guide as to what it has to achieve. You know, that thunk was about 45 different sounds all put together, you know? Everything from plunger sounds to, you know, whacking a tire really hard and reversing it. You know, there's all kinds of crazy, like, toilet-type sounds in there, and, you know, but in the end, it had to just be thunk. We recorded for all of the fighting whooshing, which is an important part of it, which in the Hong Kong films is usually fairly simple. You know, it's the same kind of whoosh over and over again. We went to technical junkyards and collected everything that made any kind of sound when you moved it. And, you know, we brought all the stuff in the studio and made every kind of whistling whoosh and pitched up, pitched it down, and played with it and processed and just created.
When the film was coming out, and then, you know, we'd hear stories about people going, you know, more than once, twice, three times, nine times, 10 times, 11 times. And then some of the emails that they were getting and some of the responses onto the film's website. And then when we heard, you know, people dressing up as characters, and, I didn't expect that at all.
Oh, yeah, I ran into people who are complete Matrix freaks. The Hollow stuntman I just worked with, who just recited every line of mine back to me all the time, and I couldn't believe they'd seen The Matrix so many times, and, you know.
And what was really gratifying to me, though, is, you know, I'll be taking a taxi someplace, or I'll just be in some non-movie situation, and it'll come up that I edited The Matrix, and people will want to talk to me about it. People want to tell me about how much it changed their lives, or how much they saw the world differently, or. And that to me personally is so exciting, to be, you know, a small but significant part of a movie that can affect people on that level. That's what success is.
To be in one film like that in your lifetime makes you extremely lucky, right? Extremely fortunate to be involved in a project like that. I've had the good fortune of being involved in two, you know, with Apocalypse Now, which is not the commercial success that The Matrix is.
Domestically, it grossed about $171 million, which is an enormous amount of money, and about $270 million foreign. So we're looking at a $450 million grossing movie, which is, in terms of Warner Brothers, it's the highest grossing film they've ever had.
For Warner Brothers, it's done a great thing for our studio, which is the hardest thing to do, which is to have a great reputation for going cutting edge and innovation, and they really brought it to our studio. I hope they never leave.
I didn't go to the awards. I just didn't think we'd win anything. A couple years ago, I had essentially the same four nominations for a movie we did called Die Hard, and we had the same nominations and won none of them.
I had the good fortune to be at that Oscar award ceremony. It was fantastic to be in the audience and to have, you know, the film announced.
I went into that evening at the Academy Awards thinking I had a shot, but thinking I wouldn't win. And I remember saying to my wife at one point, sitting next to me, I said, it's really boiling in here, isn't it? And she says, no, it's really pretty cold. The air conditioning's up full tilt, I'm freezing.
Getting the award was completely Matrix-like, like unto itself, just because, you know, you walk up there and none of it seems real in any way, and you're looking at these lights, but then you go through the curtain and it's exactly like leaving the Matrix and going into the real world. It's just all, you go through these curtains and everything's all black. There's all these people dressed in black, you know, tuxedos, with wires and gaffer's tape everywhere. It was just this completely like rigged, dirty, crazy world. It looked exactly like the world that the people in the Neb lived in, you know? Whereas up there on the stage was this manufactured world that I got to be in for a moment. So that parallel was almost too much for me. It was almost a total breakdown.
It was sad that at least I think Bill Pope and Owen Patterson both got, at least should have been nominated for, I mean, if you believe in awards or not, but I thought they should have at least been nominated for what they did.
I wish we'd gotten more nominations. Maybe we'd have won more awards. But it won awards across the board. It won awards in England. It won all the crafts in L.A. The sound people gave it an award. The editing union gave it an award. It was just a miracle that it worked so well. The idea is that we're going to make both these movies, Matrix 2 and 3, at the same time. It's not as if we're shooting them back to back, because it's one giant movie that will then be cut in half and they'll be shown in two sittings.
Everybody calls these things sequels. But from that first time when we were working on Bound, and Larry and Eddie told me about The Matrix, they always thought of it and presented it as a trilogy. And so these next two movies are the second and third parts of a trilogy, by which it's really important to see the difference, because these movies will be able to watch, you'll be able to watch all three movies together and see one big story.
It's the same antagonist, it's the same heroes, but you might as well call it Matrix Squared and Matrix Cubed, because I think those are the levels it's going to.
The Matrix was an undertaking. This is a super undertaking.
Now we gotta hide things and gotta be careful, because people are constantly looking over their shoulders. Because there's a lot of stuff in the movie that if it gets out, it'll ruin. It'll probably get out eventually, but I just hope it doesn't, because it'll just ruin the surprise.
It's been a very difficult task to mount these movies. I mean, they're enormously expensive, which is always an issue. And of course, Len and Andy are doing things that are groundbreaking again.
I could jump right to the chase and tell you, you know, that we're going completely over the top from where we were before, because, you know, the technology is there now to go for the next level.
There's stuff in this movie that nobody's ever done or seen, and it's just, as much as I liked the first one, when I read the second one, I thought it was better than the first one. Then when I read the third one's better than the second one. So, I mean, they're gonna be tiring, because they're just so amazed. There's so much stuff to take in.
I really like it. I like the revelations. I like what Neo finds out about. He found out what the Matrix was to a certain extent. And in this piece, he gets even more insight into how the Matrix works.
Well, this time we know the end of the story. And this time we know what worked and what didn't work.
I'm really anxious to see what the look will be in the real world in the next two pictures. That, I think, will be probably, or has the potential to be something really, really interesting.
You know, you should study up on your Hegel and Kant and Descartes and Judeo-Christian traditions and all the different things that are going on, because it's explored in the second and third movie. And when you see them as a whole, I think you will find there is a philosophical overlay to this entire thing that is quite profound.
It's very rare that you actually get to merge what you do with what you believe in. The Matrix has so many principles that I dig, so I think people are gonna love it.
Five kicks this time. Five kicks. Last time was three. Last time they won three, but I said four. This time I want, they said five, so I don't know what we're going to do. I might have to do this. No, I don't know.
We'll let you know. To be continued.
The end?